This next section, the aesthetics of books, edges and the breaks of space. So I'm going to try again to share the screen. That should give you that as background. On the aesthetics of books, one could also say, as the poet and literary critic Randall Jarrell emphasizes the contrast, obviously, and by compared with poets neglected owing to obscurity, Stevens was anything but neglected. Celebrated during his lifetime, still more after his death, his topics seem wonderfully accessible. How hard can it be to figure out a jar the poet places in Tennessee, or else to count off the 13 ways of looking at a blackbird, or ways to live our lives, as an NYU poet, Joan, Professor, she may also be a poet, this I don't know, we haven't met, Professor Joan Richardson tells us how to live, what to do. Leaving a mere 37 ways pop in our ears, we cannot help but echo Paul Simon, To Leave a Lover. If the later Stevens wrote about philosophy and poetry, giving a high-minded lecture 4 years before his death at the University of Chicago entitled A Collect of Philosophy, there's been no shortage of philosophers writing on Stevens. In my office library, fairly untouched for 3 decades, it was given to me by someone, the author I think gave it to him. I have Thomas J. Hines' 1976 Later Poetry of Wallace Stevens. It may be the only book on Wallace Stevens to mention William Richardson, Bill Richardson, and he gave it to me, I believe. Phenomenological parallels with Husserl and Heidegger. These days, there are a relatively large number of books on Stevens and philosophy, including one that could have been better. I'll touch on ancient lyric poetry and Archilochus below. We already mentioned that the epigraph to this paper as a whole had the author, you see Wallace Stevens and pre-Socratic philosophy there, brought Nietzsche or even Heidegger to bear on his own reading of Stevens and the pre-Socratics, and the Sebastian Gardner who wrote Wallace Stevens and Metaphysics, The Plain Sense of Things, and with a book like a comet, Things Merely Are, by Simon Critchley. Not really. It only appears so in retrospect. In fact, the emphasis in Critchley was always there, and the book was presaged by an article a decade earlier, Critchley's The Philosophical Significance of a Poem on Wallace Stevens. Still, of Critchley's book, the literary scholar Charles Altieri noted, and as there's even less of a shortage of literary readings of Stevens, this is significant, that Critchley's work would, like as not, be influential. Influential. Hal Bloom advances his own study of Stevens, distinguished by self-sufficiency, that means not too many references beyond the author's own say-so. Stepping beyond the frame, Frank Kermode supposes Stevens to have been captivated by, I quote, the virile hurdling, that was, would have been part of an alternate title of my text, and also Heidegger, whom Kermode names the old tramp, thinking perhaps of Heidegger's mustache. See it there, and hurdling's clean shave then. Kermode wants to talk philosophy if the publication of the Black Notebooks have hardly helped matters in the interim. Nor can one quite riff, as Kermode tends to do, on Hoedelin's treatment of woman as a matter of actual youthful virility by contrast with the Heidegger we see him here, who was, so Hannah Arendt might have been able to tell us, even though Giorgio Agamben underscores that their encounter took place during the writing of Being and Time, she might have said, consider the contrast here, that Heidegger would have been, in her eyes, of course, already old. For his part, and he's hardly alone in his innocence, Kermode seems unaware of Herdlin's affairs and disastrous consequences for the woman involved, let it be priestess at Gunther. But Kermode tells us that neither epithet, young or virile, would reply to Stevens. I'm thinking of Helen Vendler here, and that can be a tiny bit surprising given what Stevens says himself of masculine virility in his 1943 Mount Holyoke lecture, the figure of the youth as virile poet. Still, I've suggested that in a time of war, it can be easy to imagine, still true, how a title like that would go over at Mount Holyoke or anywhere else. A great deal has been written about this. It fascinates authors as significant and as analytically positioned as Stanley Cavell, although Cavell's essay on Stevens is a slow in starting. Even by Cavellian standards, he qualifies. Like many of Stevens' titles, the title is irresistible, especially to men, as most Stevens specialists are, with exceptions, and I've already mentioned them, like Richardson and Ventler. Stevens had his own issues, and he has a lure. If T.S. Eliot takes us to the beach, shall we wear our trousers rolled, or to London Bridge, I had not thought death had undone so many, Stevens puts his poetry in the sound of his words. His titles already tell us the idea of order at Key West. And then there's what he can do with an of. And we philosophers are more than resentful, we're jealous, writing of mere being. And with Stevens we can philosophize as we can poetize at the kitchen table. The celebration of the ordinary has been with us now for some time, and if in philosophy we largely think of Stanley Cavell on the ordinary, strangely, by way of Harvard, in quest of the ordinary, you see it here with Cavell himself. Tracy Strong writes about this, likewise via Harvard, describing his encounter with Cavell, whom, strangely, he does not name by name in an otherwise carefully detailed description of a late-night meeting with students, Cavell's late-night meeting in 1969 with an unforgettable faculty member in the preface to his The Politics of the Ordinary, a book on Jean-Jacques Rousseau. It was not persuasion, but presence. The students heard a voice. Having read the work, I saw the man. Very interesting distinction that Strong likes to make between persuasion and presence. Very Protestant. The cachet of the ordinary is today still, and to a certain extent, an homage to Cavell, but Wallace Stevens is one of its prophets. To this extent, it's relevant that a poem featured early in Stevens's first book of poetry, Harmonium, 1923, is entitled The Ordinary Woman. The word as such recurs in the title of a later poem, An Ordinary Evening in New Haven. And not only that, references to themes and to the woman, including the letters, with a crucial difference from the windowsills at the alphabets, at beta B and gamma G. What had been canting curlicues acquires weight. Reality is the beginning, not the end. Naked Alpha, not the Hierophant Omega, of dense investiture with luminous vassals. The question of Bloomian resentment is the perfection of the culture of the commonplace, and conventionally so. To go back to Horkheimer and Adorno on commodification, if you write on themes no one else writes about, no publisher will publish your work. Fairly so. One needs readers, peers for peer review, conferences to go to. Cliché is supreme for a reason, at least in letters. Peter Sloterdijk writes about Rainer Maria Rilke and his archaic torso. Because we know in tiny and precise detail all the way down, quite so, that I, that we, that you, as Rilke says, you have to change your life. Du musst dein Leben ändern. That would be the whole of Kant's categorical imperative in a word. It's no accident that this is the same claim Adorno makes with respect to Beethoven, we already mentioned it, and his rage for a lost penny. In Rilke's case, when it comes to the archaic torso of Apollo, the concision trips us. Whatever does Rilke mean by fur? Raubtierfelle. It's German, just to quote Randall Charles Deutsch durch Freud. With the Duino elegies, the length is problematic, as readers begin by supposing it's a common way to, we're going to see this again and again, already certain. What, after all, do you need to know? To know something of beauty, of the beginning of terror, quite before the poem swallows one in its entanglements, the chained order of angels. Ungesetzt selbst, es nehme einer mich plötzlich ans Herz, ich verginge von seinem stärkeren Dasein. And assuming even one of them took me suddenly to his heart, I would perish from his stronger existence, and God, and lovers, and thoughts that stay the night. So, we read Stevens with his jar, catch the care of place and placement, count the eye of the blackbird, this is before Twin Peaks, and Stevens serves as foil for Jarl, who is, because one might have, just given another world and time, written this essay on Jarl. Jarl's not only intriguing for having been quite as Hemingway was, and we'll get to Hemingway briefly, exceptionally fond of cats, but he was author of The Death of the Ball Turret Gunner, a poem so spare, almost barely more than the parlor trick played by primary school teachers on their charges, seducing them into thinking that the rhythms of poetry might be a matter of counting syllables in a recipe. Isn't that all you need for haiku? Jarl tells the story of life in its rupture, its interruption, conscious flow, ecstatic to itself, oblique, uncanny reflection. From my mother's sleep, I fell into the state, and I hunched in its belly till my wet fur froze. 6 miles from earth, loosed from its dream of life, I woke to black flock and the nightmare fighters. When I died, they washed me out of the turret with a hose. It's the rhythm that makes this poem, but it's also juxtaposition, as that works with rhyme. It is shock and it is surprise, as Archilochus first taught this with his lyric invention. The line has to catch us in its grip. I hunched in its belly till my wet fur froze. And all the viscerality of the epigrammatic apode is there. Even without Greek measures, long and short, the poet gets there with gathered horror and the visceral in its belly till my wet fur froze. I don't need to repeat the jangled reference. I fell from sleep, from the dream of life, and woke to black flack. So that, still talking, I can tell youth, still, this is a lyric, that when I died, they washed me out of the turret with the hose. It makes every bit of difference for us as philosophers to remember. Not only are Nietzsche, who writes on what he calls grand politics and what they cost in his human, all too human, but not less Thomas Hobbes, because the state into which he, the ball turret gunner, just a boy, in his dissonant fall from his mother's sleep, that state into which he fell is the Leviathan. When Stevens reflects, just to recall the ordinaries with which we began above, he speaks in examination of the hero in a time of war, and we may note the difference with the virile poet in the ideal of the line. Which is that of the common. The common man is the common hero. The common hero is the hero. imprimatur, but then this common fortune, induced by what you will, the entrails of a cat, $12 for the devil, a kneeling woman, a moon's farewell. And common fortune, induced by nothing, unwished for, chance, the merest riding of the wind, rain in a dry September, the improvisations of the cuckoos in a clock shop, soldier, sink in the darkness, repeating two neatly measured stations of less neatly measured commonplaces. Two stanzas before that, we read, the God whom we serve is able to deliver us good chemistry, good common man. What of that angelic sword, creature of 10 times 10 times dynamite, convulsive angel, convulsive shatterer? And I mentioned very briefly Lycidas just before Milton's Lycidas, and this angelic sword also reminds us of the two-handed engine at the door, stands ready to smite once and smite no more.